That is called a choir. And we are thankful for them. I have some important announcements, and some other important announcements have been laid up here since I was here late last night. This one, a pretty poster telling us that Friday, December 23rd at 7 p.m., right here in this place, and everybody is invited, there will be a free, family-friendly concert event featuring local talent. What are we laughing at? Oh, okay. So, 23rd, 7 p.m., free, family-friendly, fun concert. Over there and out there, you will find pieces of paper that look like this. This is an opportunity to get some delicious fruit and fruit-like products, and in the process, to support Love, Inc. So please take a look at it, and you might find something there that would be a perfect Christmas gift. I personally plan to use one of those apple butters if they come in as my gift for the Thankmas party. Because who doesn't love apple butter, right? And finally, today we celebrate our veterans. If you are a veteran or a family member of a veteran, please stand. The world would be a different and worse place without these people, and we thank God for them. Are there any other announcements that need to be highlighted? Then let us worship God.
Would you say the gathering prayer with me? Ever-present God, your word says that you are always with us, but sometimes we do not feel it. Your word says that you rule right now, but sometimes we do not see it. Give us faith to trust you. Give us grace to perceive your loving presence and to see some of the ways you are working in the world. Equip, empower, and guide each of us to receive and to share your truth and love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Oh,
Please be seated. Please. In Colossians chapter 1, we read these words. In Christ, God came to reconcile all things to himself, making peace through the blood of the cross. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our sin. Eternal God, our Creator, Savior, and Judge, we confess that we sometimes do the right things for the wrong reasons. We sometimes seek the approval and praise of people rather than the reward which you promise for good deeds done in secret. We forget that your verdict on us is the only verdict that counts. We sin by what we do and by what we leave undone. We sin by the words we say and by the words we leave unsaid. We also sin by failing to forgive others as fast and freely as you forgive us. Lord Almighty and Triune, please forgive us and give to each of us a transforming experience of your boundless, amazing love for us. Create in us the desire and the power to please you in all that we think and say and do, and give us the great joy and peace that come from living as your grace-saved, gratitude-filled children. These things we ask in the mighty name of our risen Redeemer and living Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus bore our sins in his body on the cross, and he did it so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. In Jesus, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And that's just because, well, for the sake of travel, in particular because Tom is in the choir. Small talk and anthem for now, and probably going forward, will be flip-flopped. So anthem now, children next.
Oh, Lord, my God. I do see some children out there. Come on down. Don't be bashful. Don't be shy. Come a little closer. I won't bite you. Oh, look at these guys. Come on. Come on up front here, closer. Come on. There you go. Hey, I like them. I like those light-up shoes. They are really cool. Do you like those shoes? Well, today we are very joyful. We are joyful because God calls us to be joyful in His house. We are so happy to be here together. We are happy that you're here. We are really happy that the choir's back. The choir helps us sing and sing out. And why do we sing in church? Does anybody know? Do you know why we sing in church? Think about it. We sing for the joy of God. We sing to praise God. That's why we do it. We just don't do it to fill time before the pastor speaks. Okay? We sing hymns so that we can praise God and we can make a joyful noise. Okay? And some of us make more of a noise than a joy, but it's joyful at any rate. Okay? So when you come to church, I want you to be joyful, okay? And it takes less muscles to smile than to frown. So give me a big old smile. You guys make me laugh. Let's praise God through our prayer. Dear God, we are so joyful for your love and your guidance and your direction. Help us to make a joyful noise unto you in all that we say and all that we do as we praise your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, you guys can go on back and sit with your families. What?
I have a wiggly tooth.
Oh, you have a wiggly tooth.
Would you say the prayer for illumination with me? Loving God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth with faith. Give us also grace to respond with love, gratitude, and obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Before I jump into scripture reading, I want to take care of a little housekeeping stuff. A few weeks ago, I mentioned some evidence for the historical reliability of the Bible and said that if anybody wanted a copy, they could have one. Not many people have asked for one, but they are still available. In fact, the Bible is a history book, but more than that, the Bible is God's word to us. Also, I am profoundly grateful for Joe and Nat and Kai and the other musicians who have given us, especially during COVID, a new sound and new style. But I'm also profoundly grateful for our choir. And you can join me in clapping whether or not. Coming up with titles for sermons is one of my least favorite things. One of the reasons that I dislike it so much is it's hard to kind of encapsulate a message in a single sentence. If a sermon could be encapsulated in a single sentence, why bother preaching it? Some people will come up with these snappy sermon titles, but they're not really descriptive or helpful. I've already had one positive comment on today's sermon title. Any of you look at it? It's just a question mark. That question mark is not saying, will there be a sermon? The question mark is due to the fact that, for various reasons, the bulletin had to be printed on Wednesday. And as of Wednesday, what was the sermon title? I don't know. If you want one, we'll call it Praising God for His Mighty Acts, Past, Present, and Future. The passage I picked for today is Psalm 98. And it is one of the four passages prescribed for today by the Revised Common Lectionary. Psalm 98 is always prescribed by the lectionary every Christmas day. And for those of you who might have forgotten or don't know, the lectionary is just a 3-year cycle of scripture passages prescribed for each Sunday. And many churches are required to preach one of the four lectionary passages. For Presbyterians, it's not required, it's just strongly suggested. So, in the 3-year cycle of prescribed readings in the Revised Common Lectionary, Psalm 98 occurs every Christmas plus 2 additional times, which means that we have 5 opportunities every 3 years to hear and preach from this passage. And yet, strangely, I've never done it. In almost 30 years, I have never preached on Psalm 98. And after having labored on this until almost 1 o'clock last night, I now know why. Lord, our rock and redeemer, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. In Jesus' name, amen. We'll read it in a minute, but I want to tell you a little bit about it. Psalm 98 celebrates God as Savior and as judge. To me, and I want to know what you think, but to me, Psalm 98 sounds like it was written all about Jesus, particularly his first coming and his second coming. And that's probably why it is one of the four readings prescribed for Christmas Day every single year. Psalm 98 sounds like it's about Jesus. But of course, it was written before Jesus became human flesh. But we are not wrong when we see Jesus in the Old Testament, including the Psalms. We are not wrong when we see Jesus in the Old Testament, including the Psalms, because Jesus himself invites us to look for him there. He says, the freshly risen Jesus on the first Easter day said to his gathered disciples, this is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be written. This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that was written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. We have our Lord's invitation to look for him on every page of the Old Testament. With that in mind, please listen to Psalm 98. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. God's word for us, God's children. The 116 of the 150 Psalms have superscriptions that tell us a little bit about them and sometimes about the author. But the superscription of Psalm 98 is simply a psalm. It's the shortest superscription there is, and it's not real helpful. We don't know who wrote Psalm 98, but we do know that it is an anonymous call to praise God. An anonymous call to praise God. And like ripples in a pond, the praise called for expands in outward moving concentric circles. In the first circle, verses 1-3, the people of ethnic Israel are being called to praise and to celebrate God. In the second circle, all people, all of humanity is being called to praise and to celebrate the God of Israel. And finally, in the third circle, verses 7-9, creation itself, sea creatures, non-human land creatures, clapping rivers, whatever that is, and singing mountains are called to praise the God of Israel. From start to finish, Psalm 98 is filled with joyful praise and celebration of God. Verse 1, very appropriate for the day we get the choir back, says, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and holy arm have worked salvation for him. Those words, right hand and holy arm, have worked salvation for him. It means that God did it by God's own strength and without anybody's help. God doesn't need our help to save. Jesus did it all by himself. But there is something a little bit strange going on here. This psalm calls ethnic Israel, and then all of humanity, and then all of creation, to praise and celebrate God for marvelous things. And that praise and celebration is because of some mighty act of salvation. Now, here and in many places in the Old Testament, the word salvation does not mean what we normally think as New Testament people. In the New Testament, salvation almost always refers to God's saving work in and as Jesus. God's saving work by which we are freed from the penalty of sin and freed from the power of sin and given eternal life. But in the Old Testament, the word salvation usually refers to some act of rescue, not final eternal life salvation, but to some occasion when God stepped into world history and rescued his people. That's what salvation usually means in the Old Testament. The salvation being celebrated, the action for which people are called to praise, and this is the strange part, we're not told what it is. Ethnic Israel and all humans and all of creation are called to praise God for marvelous deeds, but those marvelous deeds are left unnamed, at least for the first six verses. So, for what marvelous deed are the people being called to praise God? Well, it could be referring to the Exodus from Egypt, when God liberated his people from slavery and began to bring his people into a new promised land and a new relationship with God and a new way of life. The salvation being celebrated could refer to the events of 701 BC, when God miraculously defended the city of Jerusalem from Sennacherib's attack. And by the way, Sennacherib's own writings affirm that God defended Jerusalem when he attacked it. It could, the marvelous deed that we're being called to praise for, could refer to the return from the Babylonian exile. Or it could refer to something completely different. When we move to the second section, verses 4 through 6, that's when all people are called to praise God. That's crystal clear. All humans are called to praise the God of Israel. But here's something strange. All humans are called to praise the God of Israel, who, of course, is the God whom we know best as Jesus Christ. But the funny thing, the weird thing, is this. It seems that all humanity is being called to praise the God of Israel because of mighty deeds that God did for Israel. In other words, humanity is being called to praise the God of Israel for stuff that God did, not for the people praising. Humanity is being called to praise the God of Israel for things that God did for Israel. And that is really strange, because throughout most of human history, and even into the present, most nations don't like Israel very much. For 4,000 years, Israel has been one of the least popular kids on the map. And that's part of being God's elect people. Being chosen by God does not make one popular in the world. It hasn't for 4,000 years in Israel, and it doesn't for followers of Jesus Christ today. In fact, Jesus says, "Do not be surprised if the world hates you because of me." But remember, they hated me first. So the world, non-Israel, being called to praise the God of Israel for things done for Israel. Here's what I think is going on in those verses. I think all nations of the earth, all humans, are being called to see what God has done for Israel and to realize that the God of Israel is the true God, or at least the ultimate God. And having come to that realization, all of the world, all humans, are thereby called to put their faith in the God of Israel. As I said before, in the first two sections, the first six verses, we do not know what particular mighty and marvelous acts of God for which people are called to celebrate and give praise. But in that third and final section, verses 7 through 9, that changes. In the third section, verses 7 through 9, we know exactly why God is being praised and celebrated. The reason is made explicit in verse 9, which says, "Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with equity." Psalm 98 begins with jubilant celebration of an unspecified past event. in which God acted mightily for God's people Israel. But after celebrating that unspecified past act of God, Psalm 98 moves into an unbelievably jubilant anticipation of Judgment Day. Joyfully anticipating Judgment Day. Well, many people don't joyfully anticipate Judgment Day. In fact, when I was much younger, I used to pray the Lord's Prayer. And when I'd come to the part, Thy Kingdom Come, I'd be like, but not yet. But not yet. However, things have changed. When I pray Thy Kingdom Come now, I mean, anytime you're ready. And the reason is I've changed, and the world has changed, and I've realized that the best day on this earth is cruddy compared to the worst day in God's coming kingdom. So we can joyfully anticipate Judgment Day if we're followers of Jesus Christ, if we're blood-bought, grace-saved children of God. There are some people who doubt that there will ever be a Judgment Day. But it's really this simple. Either Jesus is right, and there will be a Judgment Day, or the people who say there's no Judgment Day are right and Jesus is wrong. Which do you think is true? If you don't think Jesus is right, please see me after the service. The final three verses of Psalm 98 are strange for another reason. Because this joyful celebration of which we are given a glimpse does not focus on humans. There are some people who, when I preached the mini-series on Revelation and talked about animals praising God and eternity, they're like, I don't really see that. Well, that's okay. We'll find out when we get there. But the people who didn't like that idea won't like this either. But it's there, and you can't argue with it. The celebrating and praising done in the final three verses is not done by humans. The praising and celebration done by humans is limited to the first six verses. In verses 7 through 9, it is non-human creation, praising and celebrating God. Verse 7 speaks of the sea and all that is in it. Fish, whales, plankton, praising God. The next verse speaks of the earth and all that is in it. Now, given that verse 7 obviously is talking about non-human sea creatures, the next phrase, the earth and all that is in it, probably refers to non-human land creatures. And that interpretation gains some support from the fact that in the next verse, rivers are clapping their hands and mountains are singing their praise. Please listen again. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity. There are probably not best give statistics. I haven't read everything written on this psalm. Read a lot. But there is a slender sliver minority of scholars whom have studied on this passage who think that this is all metaphor. But that's just a slim sliver. Almost all of the scholars I consulted, probably 8 or 9 this week, about this passage recognize that this is, while it's pictorial language, it's talking about non-human creation praising God. And if that sounds weird, consider this. Romans 8 tells us that creation is what? I'm in no hurry. What's creation doing in Romans 8? Groaning! All of creation is groaning. 8:22, I believe. And here in Psalm 98, we're clearly told that when God brings this current creation to an abrupt end on Judgment Day, creation itself will joyfully celebrate and praise the Creator. Why? Why will creation joyfully praise and celebrate the Creator on Judgment Day? Well, right now, Romans 8 says, creation is groaning. Creation is not groaning because of pollution. Creation is not growing because of global warming. Creation is growing because of human sin. Why do we know that? Because there was very little pollution and no global warming when Paul wrote those words. Creation is groaning because of human sin. Ever since God created the earth, creation and humanity have been intertwined and connected. The fall of humanity, described in Genesis 3, had devastating effects on the earth itself. Romans 8:20 says, "For the creation waits in eager expectation for the children of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in the hope that creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and glory of the children of God." Creation will someday praise and celebrate the Creator on Judgment Day, because on that day, God will make all things right, and God will bring forth a new and improved, perfect creation. Judgment Day will include a reckoning. Jesus says in Revelation 22, "Behold, I am coming soon, and my reward is with me to give to each person according to what they have done." There will be a reckoning on Judgment Day. But that's not all. Judgment Day is also the day when all things are made new. Judgment Day is a day when God will right every wrong, heal every hurt, and fix everything that's broken. Hallelujah. From then on and forever, God will rule over a perfect universe in which there is no pain, no suffering, no death, and not even any stress. That is something we can joyfully anticipate. As Christians, we are by definition, we are forward-looking, future-focused people. We are urged repeatedly in the New Testament to always be mindful of the eternal future that God has promised to us. Brothers and sisters in Christ, remembering the future that God promises to us, gives us great strength and courage in the present. Remembering the future gives us strength and courage in the present. Psalm 98 begins with these words: "Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things." We're not given the lyrics to that song. We're called to make one up. But I want to end today. Can anybody say, thank God he's going to end? I want to end today with a new song to which we are given the lyrics. This new song to which we are given the lyrics is recorded for us in Revelation chapter 5. It's a new song that is sung in heaven, and it's sung by the mysterious four living creatures and the equally mysterious 24 elders. We don't know who either of those people are, or either of those beings are, the four living creatures, the 24 elders. But both context and content clearly show us that this song is sung to Jesus. And it's about the greatness of Jesus, about the salvation that God accomplished through Jesus, and about the glorious eternity of all of God's grace-saved, blood-bought people. So without further ado, please hear the new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priest to serve our God, and they will reign on earth. Isn't that a lovely song? I don't know what the setting is. I can't quite hear the music. Those guys and that guy probably can hear music on that. But I'm just going to read it one more time because it's so beautiful. Singing to Jesus, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and nation and people and language. You have made them to be a kingdom and priest to serve our God, and they will reign on earth. Please pray with me. Lord, grant us grace to receive your word. Grant us grace to live in joyful response, in obedience, in love, in anticipation of your coming kingdom. And Lord, until you come in power and glory, we ask that you would rule in us, in our daily decisions, in the words we say and the deeds we do, and in so doing, help us to be the salt and light that you call us to be. Lead the leaders of this world. Reach out your mighty arm and holy hand and help those whose problems are bigger than our abilities, and open our eyes to see where we can help, and open our hands to do what we can. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, praying also the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hi, my name is Rose Nystrom. I currently serve on the church's session and have called First Church my home for more than 40 years. During these stressful times, we want you to know that we are praying for you. Even as our sanctuary doors have reopened, I continue to be thankful for modern technology, which allows us all to meet in spirit. Recently, I felt drawn to Matthew 25:40, in which the scripture points out that when we do something for the least of God's creation, we are doing it for Christ himself. I would like to extend to you a call to give, whether by your actions or monetarily. You may contribute to the ministries here at First Presbyterian by dropping an envelope in the collection box on your way into or out of the sanctuary, by dropping a check in the mail, or by visiting our website, TitusvillePresbyterian.com. Thank you for your continued generosity. I pray you will find your hearts refreshed and your burdens just a little lighter.
Say the prayer of thanksgiving and dedication with me. Risen Lord Jesus, suffering for our sins and dying in our place, you gave your all for us. We offer these gifts as expressions of our deep gratitude. Lord, increase our gratitude and help us to increasingly live the new life you died to give us. Amen.
Of glory divine.
It's almost like all these pieces of the service fit together. And now, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace today and forever. Amen.
My song, praising my Savior.